system.
All right, cool, cool, cool. I think people can hear us. I think we're good.
Yeah, I think we're good. Okay, so I think maybe we should do intros.
All right. So, right. Thank you for bearing with us on these hilarious technical difficulties. It's always like this, no matter what. It's Zoom, it's live. Today I was on an obnoxious phone call. It was just, you know, it's all these things. But I think, Kadijah, you probably covered this while I was trying to log on, but we're going to just do, you know, each of us wrote a piece in the book Teaching Resistance, which if you haven't read it yet, you should. There are multiple pieces. There it is from anarchists, anti-authoritarians, and educators of all stripe. You know, we come from a particular perspective. We're Black folk. We're, you know, Black folk socialized as women in this colonial project called America. And our pieces really speak to that. So we're going to talk a little bit about those, but really more... we're going to speak to the broader movement that's happening around us. And, you know, we're going to tie in as much as possible. We're going to do basically like the next 40 minutes here. Then we're going to take a break, and then we're going to jump back on it around 5. So basically 2 hours, we're going to have Q&A. And we are moderated here. By Teaching Resistance via John Marchmeek, who is a G and the editor of Teaching Resistance, both the book and the Maximum Rock and Roll column. And he's just going to kind of keep us sort of on task, on schedule. A little bit about me. If you don't know me, my name is Melissa. I've been here in the Bay Area for 300 years. My pronouns are she, her, hers, cis, Black, queer. I got like 900 identifiers. I'm going to just leave it at that for now. I've been an educator in the Bay for a really long time, mainly specializing in early childhood education, positive discipline, restorative justice, restorative practices, which we're going to talk about. This does not mean I'm a pacifist. I want to be clear about that too.
Exactly.
I've been involved in DIY punk culture here in the Bay Area and I guess across the country for some time. I'm semi-retired from punk rock now, and I'm currently coming to you live from an undisclosed location in a cabin in the woods. And that's the homie Kadijah, who Kadijah's the future, y'all.
Oh, please. That's way too kind. What can I say about myself? I'm Kadijah. I have an essay in this phenomenal book. I'm so proud to be in this book with Melissa. What a brilliant thinker. What a... just such an honor.
About you.
About me. yeah, I'm all about radical education and really diving into the imaginative work of future building, you know? And so I'm really interested in like studying the past so that we have understandings of what is possible for the future. And so, yeah, I guess I would not call myself a historian, but I'm a lover and fan of history. And I like to learn about the way past autonomous cultures have functioned. And so hopefully we will get to talk a little bit about that today as we talk about new categories and new arrangements for being and what that means from an anarchist perspective, what that means just from a Black radical perspective, and all the other delineations of that. How does that sound?
Sounds right.
I think we should jump in on some teaching resistance right now.
Let's do it. This book covered so many things, and we I think in both of our pieces really tried to We try to come for and from education, like really, again, from the ECE side. And then also, Kadijah, your piece really spoke a lot. Coming from, like, you know, the end of high school, like what, you know, and high school in the Bay Area, like that's actually something I cannot speak to, having not grown up here. But I mean, you were basically at school in Berkeley when all of a sudden it was cool to hang nooses from trees and whatnot. Like,
right. So what I can say about Berkeley High and my experience there, and just being a student, being a kid, at the time, I mean, like I was a teenager, but I was a kid, you know? And the massive amount of responsibility that Black youth has to be prepared to articulate, you know, just how bad things are in order for things to be changed is a burden that no children should have. You know, I felt a huge responsibility to not only detail the abuse and suffering of Black kids at Berkeley High, but of pretty much all Black people, and try to express that message to these administrators who only care about attendance. You know, people who did, to some extent, cared about, you know, stimulating thought and sowing dissension, but for the most part, we're just focused on getting kids butts in seats. And so it was really hard to balance both, like trying to care about Black people and to try to take care of myself as a child at that time. And so I think a lot of the stuff that comes out of my writing at that time is a feeling of, well, if you would just listen to us and consider our needs, And so it's both like I'm impressed and happy with that work, and also sad that it couldn't flourish into let's imagine this new possibility, because I was stuck in survival mode almost all the time.
Right.
And so, especially in the Bay Area, where, I mean, Berkeley High is a little bit more radical. The reason that I was even publishing an MMR is because my economics teacher was like, hey, do you know about this? You know? And so there are cool folks sprinkled in there, but by and large, it's people who are more focused on meeting the status quo than they were with preparing young minds for, you know, tearing shit up pretty much.
And it's,
you
know, such a thing.
That's an important thing for kids to learn, is this, like, this, to trust their gut, to trust their feelings about things, to be ready to tear shit up. And that, like, preparing kids to be obedient should not be the, like, sole purpose of education. Actually, it shouldn't be a purpose of education at all.
Right. Right.
You know,
and it's such a piece of, like, it's like the piece around, like, what is critical thinking and how does that come in, right? I know, like, one of the things that really resonated for me around your piece was that aspect, right, where, like, not only do you have to, you have to be educated to, like, kind of save your life if you're Black, right? And, I mean, I know that, like, in my piece, I definitely talk, I speak a little bit to, like, an earlier start in school, but it's always hammered into you, right? Like, if you don't have education, you ain't shit. If you don't have education, you're not going to be able to do shit. But then it's like, you know, like you come to some sort of consciousness that's like, if you actually don't have education and excel at it and do everything you're supposed to do, like within the status quo, within these lines, then you're not going to go anywhere, right? And then here we are now where, like, you know, for good or for bad, right, like everybody in the United States who's at least a little bit left-leaning knows about the new Jim Crow, right? Everybody who's a little bit left-leaning can now talk about school-to-prison pipeline. But there's like this other part that's missing where it's like you don't actually recognize, like they don't actually recognize that like, the heightened awareness, the heightened visibility of like Black struggle and Black struggle in education and Black struggle around all the different pathways to confinement actually, it makes it harder for Black folk to just fucking get by, to just be be in school, be, you know, be a kid, right? Like you were saying, like in your piece, like you were a kid, like in high school, but, you know, and so it's like that, that other piece where, and I wanted to talk about this a little bit today around visibility, right? Like how, like when our struggles become visible, it's generally because somebody's been murdered, right? Or somebody's been unfairly imprisoned. And then there's always that shadow, right? Like you kind of can't live in a way. And I was thinking, like we can go in so many directions, but I'm thinking about the young student that they're calling Grace right now, right? 15 years old, she's on probation. It's COVID times, so everybody's doing distance learning, and she like didn't do her homework, and so her judge put her in jail for 2 months because she didn't do her homework. And it's an extreme case, right? But it's 100% related to like how we stay confined, we stay policed, and how our visibility sometimes like works to visibility of our struggle works to our detriment. Right.
I wanted to take this in a little bit of a different direction, but I definitely agree with you, and that poses some really interesting questions for me. But when I first heard you say visibility and talking about when the like when Black struggle becomes visible to people is after death, after murder, and one thing that's so horrible about that is partially the framing is because we're talking about that from a lens of white people realizing or non-Black right. people realizing because that's right. when it becomes becomes at the forefront for them. But on the other hand, it's like, when do I feel most connected to my organizing is after a murder of another Black person. Mm. And that's upsetting to me because what happens in the downtime between those is not, you know, okay, let's lean in as much as we can. Let's build up mutual aid, whatever. It's also kind of, I mean, that's happening. But on the other hand, we're so tired, you know, we are so tired yes. and so broken and trying to repair ourselves from that continual reminder that people don't give a fuck about Black people. You know, and even some Black people don't care about Black women, about Black trans women, about any about Black queer people. And that includes Black cis women, you know, not caring about Black trans women, not caring about and Black cishet women, not caring about queer people, you know. And so like there's so many times like it's like we can all come together for 5 minutes, like a virtual 5 minutes to talk about and care about someone dying, but we also are so tired in between that we can't really build, you know? Right. And then when we are building, it feels, it's just hard to be of two minds, you know, all the time, like to constantly be focused on the death and also trying to do growth. Like, and we right. can do both things. It's not to say that we can't, it's just so exhausting. And I don't want to harbor too much on that, but when we start talking about visibility, I start thinking about that. And I also start thinking about the way we choose who is going to represent a movement, you know, and how frequent that it is, how frequently it's cishet men, you know, because people trust a Black cishet man because historically right. that's who they've looked to. And
ooh, you better slow down. They're not ready.
Like, historically, people have like really propped up these Black cishet men, regardless of the reality of so many women leaders, of so many queer leaders. You know, I mean, not that those things exist separately only either. You right. know, but like that right. is It's one of the biggest things I think about when we're talking about visibility, because why else are we focusing so heavily on what athletes and entertainers have to say about Black liberation, you know? And there's been a really large movement of people talking about like celebrity culture and them wanting it to die. But what's so critical to me, like the most exciting part of that is to think about, you know, how do we get to a place where we're looking for one or two leaders? how do we get to a place where we're thinking of, like, the we're looking towards the elite to tell us about our communities?
Come with it.
Like, how do we get there? How does like, and that's no that's no shade to, like, LeBron James, like, and people, like, I'm not on a wave of telling him to shut up and dribble. Like, that is not what I'm saying here. But what I'm saying is, how do we even get to a position where these are the people we are relying on for information about how Black people feel?
You know,
especially when we're Black.
It's
like,
you know,
I feel like this comes back to nonviolent communication to some extent, because, like, when people are asked to prioritize themselves, to communicate their needs, to think about, you know, what works for them and for their community, they're empowered. They are in control. Right. You know, they've built this autonomous place for them. And so, like, there has been a major disconnect. There's been, like, a major disconnect and an intentional severing of power from the individual and the community, and, like, the elite.
Ooh.
And, like, that, I can't really.
It's getting too hot. Slow down. Wait a minute.
That is intentional. The idea that you need to ask an outside authority, you know, for permission or for clarification or for talking points, you know, for them to be relevant. Like, it's relevant. If you're thinking it and you're Black, it can be relevant. But also, you know, it needs to be radical.
So I feel like you're drawing some important connections here that might seem elementary, but maybe they ain't. Maybe they need to get explored. You're making connections between capitalism, right? Who we listen to based on their status, right? Patriarchy and paternalism, again, who we listen to based on their status. And yeah, no, I feel you. No shade to LeBron. And, like, and can I get a few milli?
A lot, like, of shade to DeRay. Like, no shade to LeBron, but lots of shade to DeRay and those like him, you know, but.
Right. But like, bringing someone, it in, right?
Like, someone has given them a platform. Like, we, to some extent, have given them a platform. And I want to challenge people to really interrogate, you know, what brings us to this position where these are our people, you know, because they can tweet or because they can regurgitate information from the ground. Like, what makes them now the experts? I don't even want to say experts.
Right.
That's not even.
Well, it's a trip, right? It's like what I was saying before. It's both a blessing and a curse that now, you know, lefties understand that the school to prison pipeline or school to confinement pipelines are a thing. It's both a blessing and a curse. I mean, right? Like folks forgot, like, all of a sudden everybody understands intersectionality, but they don't know who talked about that. They don't know who Patricia Hill was, who was talking about, you know, triple consciousness, or at this, like, quadruple consciousness. And so, like, and there is, like, you know, there's, like, kind of a severing from like, maternal and matriarchal understandings and ways of being. And also, you know, like, if we are really, like, going back to it, like, folks believe, it's like they believe suddenly that they're woke. It's a term that I don't use because I find it obnoxious.
Well, I never really liked it because I'm always trying to get out of the binary, you know?
And
I'm working on a project right now that's asking us, like, how do we think beyond left and right as our political, like, spectrum things? But, like, there's no awake people and asleep people. Learning is a continuous spectrum, you know? Mm. And that,
like, say it again.
And you saying that makes it, like, just circles back to what I'm saying about, like, how do we even get to these specific people as our stopping place? You know, there should be no stopping place. We are all responsible to some extent for our learning, and there are many places to look, and there's not one, you know, there's no Sean King. There should be no Sean King.
You better stop. We're about to get sued here on IG Live. This is, like, damn.
It's, like, that should be
spicy up here.
And
yeah. Well, okay, let me ask you a question. Right? We're talking about like visibility and like who's visible. And I'm gonna ask you this question rhetorically, but I feel like there are some folk out here who maybe need to hear you say what the answer is or what you think the answer is, right? And it goes a little something like this. So we said at the top of this, right, Black folk have been dying at the hands of white people and the state since the beginning of this colonial project. Check. That means that Black mothers have been mourning since the beginning of this colonial project. Check. It means that Black women have been organizing, right, against this type of white supremacist patriarchal violence, right? Check, check, and check again. So why is it that when it's going down in Portland, a bunch of white moms put on some bike helmets and all of a sudden folk are talking about moms have taken to the front lines to defend Black lives?
Well, I partially blame the discourse around the Black body.
Come on, say more.
I blame, it's not really blame. I was grateful for that term at the time that it came out because, you know, I felt like it was helping people remember that Black people are humans. Like, recognizing the humanity of Black people is central, you know, to helping people stop a genocide, helping people recognize the plight of a people. But on the other hand, you know, it also alienates people from, like, the humanity of Black people, because how many people are referring to themselves as a body, you know?
Right.
And so in doing that, we've really created a massive separation between Black people as people who have relationships and who have familial relationships to other Black people. And also this comes down to who gets to be innocent, who gets to be pure. Because when we're thinking of motherhood, people have positioned women as givers, as nurturers, as like their sole purpose is to provide more humans for us, you know? And this actually ends up being super transphobic, you know, but that's the state for you, you know, because it says that to be a woman, you need to provide kids. And there's plenty of cis women who can't have kids, but that's not the point. The point is, like, by categorizing women as baby makers, and then categorizing Black women as never women, and never having access to femininity or the category of woman, you're making motherhood and the value that you can produce to capitalism and to society being motherhood only attainable to white women. And so does that make sense? Should I say, is this making sense to people? Like, so
I feel like I need to survey the crowd. I need to know, yeah, did you I all hear what she just said?
Because what I'm saying here is, like, since chattel slavery, we're literally talking about Black women never being considered women, never having those rights, never being a part of that category at all whatsoever. And so people, like, our collective imagination of who can be a mother, who can be a woman, who can, you know, be attached to femininity and therefore innocence and purity can never include Black women. So the idea of white moms coming to save the day is fundamentally American. It's fundamentally white supremacist. It's fundamentally fucked up. It's fundamentally fucked. Like, you know, and honestly, it's not about them. It's not about these individuals. It's not about, it's not even about these white moms, to be honest, because I don't want for them to be a category of purity, innocence, and womanhood, which means giving birth, you know?
That's right. So, that's right. And we have a couple of folks here in the comments who are like, yeah, you know, like, in this country, Black women were capital. This other person says there have always been Black mothers on the front lines, often losing their kids. You know, and we don't, and this person says we don't take note until it's a wall of white. And that's a whole other word.
I think that is a word, especially because, you know, why is it that people pay attention when white people have something to say? Why is there such a surge and rise of like white diversity and inclusion facilitators? Why does that happen? Because mm-hmm. people expect black people to stand up for their rights. They don't expect, I mean, they don't, and this goes into respectability. People expect black people to stand up for their rights. That's nothing special. But if you do want to be special, then you need to adhere and assimilate to white culture.
Right. And so hold up, because I want to say two things here. No, I'm going to say three things. One, if y'all didn't already know, now you know that Kadijah is a real one. And this is why I'm telling you, that she's the future. All right. Here's another thing, right? And I'm not going to get too personal with it, but like just a touch, because it's like I'm coming off of the heels of this very thing whereby I have a lot of contact with the state and state agencies right now because of a personal thing that we ain't going to talk about here. And the point being that I'm relatively articulate. Like I can speak, you know, university English. I can write well. My words come to me all right. And I can actually summarize a point pretty quickly. But when I'm in a room with a handful of white ladies, many of whom are social workers, sorry, y'all, but come collect your social worker homies. the way that I'm perceived, you know, again, even talking like this, is as aggressive, disrespectful, not listening. So sometimes I'm just like, fuck it, I'm going to just throw a bottle at somebody's head because it's how you see me anyways. But anyways, that's beside the point. I bring this up because we're talking about, right, like that somebody here says.
Specific. That was real specific. I mean,
but you know, it's like, so somebody here just mentioned the optics of perceived credibility. And I think that sort of looping back to what we're talking about and bringing in the arc around education is critical, right? Like, because yeah, like now that, you know, a wall of white, as somebody so eloquently put it, has, you know, marched to the fore against federal troops who are firing chemical agents at people who are just demonstrating, right? Now, all of a sudden, we kind of are expected to rise to the level of respectability that these white martyrs in bike helmets are bringing up, right? And so in this way, again, our struggle is visible, but we're also now, we're being surveilled in this way, right? And we're going to be disciplined negatively, I should mention. We're going to be disciplined negatively because of the ways in which we might want to show up. For example, if I have been literally doing what that wall of white has been doing for 42 years and ain't nobody listening, and I finally throw a bottle, that wall of white might turn around on me and it might call the cops on me. Or if I'm in school, it might send me to the office, which might mean that I missed out on whatever arbitrary lesson I got to learn, which means that thus, and so, because that wall of white has now read the new Jim Crow and understands the school to prison pipeline, they're going to be like, oh shit, Melissa missed so many days of class. We know where she's headed.
That was fucking hilarious. Okay.
We know where she's headed.
That is true. I mean, I have on my Insta, like a little blurb I wrote about outside agitators, because I saw all these white liberals kind of posting like, oh, these outside agitators are coming and they're disrupting the protest and we're peaceful, always making sure to paint themselves as peaceful in comparison to these violent protesters. I was like, okay, first of all, let's not even start from where I want to start. Let's just start from, do you think that people should be calm in the face of racism? You know, no matter what. No matter what form racism or white supremacy takes, they should be calm. Like, because that is pretty much the undertone of that. Where I want to start with it is when you decide to divide a movement, it makes it easier to infiltrate and to conquer. We've seen this time and time again with grassroots organizations, and absolutely in like large demonstrations like Occupy and now, you know, like we see if you have a narrative of there's outside agitators, we need the police. We have fucking white liberals literally giving up protesters to the police in the name of protecting order, in the name, like literally endangering black people and white people who are there for like to cause mayhem, which I'm not mad at. I've heard a lot of black people being upset at the white anarchists, quote unquote, you know, for coming and fucking shit up, but I could never be mad at that personally. Are you mad at it?
No, I ain't mad at all. I'm like, who are these white anarchists we're talking about all the damn time?
You know, yeah, and it, like, it's just, I feel like I didn't approach this in a straightforward enough way so that it can really resonate with y'all. But what I'm trying to really hit home here is the idea of what even is an outside agitator when we're talking about a community. You know, like, how is someone outside of a community? And this, it gets more complex as we talk about imagined communities. Like, is the United States total a community? Like, is Florida, are those my community members? I'm from California. Like, I have little connection to people in Florida or little understanding of what's going on with them. Like, the only reason I imagine them closer to me than Italians or Brazilians is because of this imagination of the United States as a unified thing. You know, and my indoctrination into that imagination. So, into that collective imagination, because we're all kind of imagining ourselves as a community. So what is it to say that black people in Florida coming to California to protest, they are outside agitators? Like, aren't we all a part of one community? So that's number one. Then number two, you know, okay, so people who ideologically differ from you in tactics are now, you know, worthy of being abused and arrested by the police. What's your end goal with that? You know, like, okay, yeah, you guys don't want to fight the cops. Fine. You know, I don't fuck with it, but if you don't want to, that's fine. But you can't come to the protest and then throw people into like potential state violence. And it's not really a big potential. Like, that's a tiny potential because it's going to be state violence. You know what I mean? Yeah. So, like, you're literally leaving these people vulnerable to that because you are uncomfortable with the idea of violent revolution, which is necessary for change. There has literally not been a situation where you can beg and peacefully protest your way out of oppression. That is ahistorical.
Frederick Douglass!
It's ahistorical as fuck. It, like, that does not exist. And so, this is what we were supposed to talk about later, but I need to say it now. Can I say it now?
Oh, wait! Wait, hold on. You need to hold it because there's, I think the dissent is important, right? So there's a person here in our comments who says, I've seen a lot of white anarchists, quote unquote, not taking responsibility for the risk of their actions at protests in spaces where people aren't being empowered to make informed decisions. Okay. And that's a deep one.
So yeah, I think that is an essential take. And I've talked about it with one of my little brothers because, you know, he saw a video of this young black girl. Many of you have probably seen it. And she's like screaming at these white people who are going with they're not even throwing Molotov cocktails. They're like throwing rocks and using skateboards to break down this building. And it's her like nonviolent protest. And she's like, stop, no, you know, and you can see so much pain and upsetness and anger for her. And lots of black people rally behind her to be like, white people should not be infiltrating these protests. White people should be following whatever rules black people set out for them, you know, and that's how it should be. And so I absolutely feel them on that, you know, like it's definitely a tricky situation for this young black woman to be interfacing with that kind of what she considers to be violence. But violence doesn't happen against buildings, number one. And number two, black people don't exist as a monolith. So to ask white people to defer to black people to make decisions for them, there will be many black people who tell them they should do that and many other black people who tell them they should not. So that is
That's
not
right.
going to be an acceptable like direction to white people. And I'm all about making really clear explanations / expectations of people because clear expectations create safety. This is a nonviolent communications chat. Everything will come back there, you know? And so to answer Fox's question or statement, you know, this assumes that poor white people are not in danger of police or state violence. It's not to say that white people cannot endanger black people, but by stepping outside as a black person at a protest, you are already in maximum danger, in my opinion. I do think it's in the spectrum, so I don't want to paint with too broad strokes here. But by going to a protest as a black person, that's already putting you in the line of fire. Like, by already walking around black, like, or going to sleep in your bed, you know, any of those things are putting you in danger. So I don't know if white people, I don't know. I guess the answer is truly that I don't know, because I do believe it exists on a spectrum, but I think that it's so close together by the time you're at a protest where police are, that white people fucking shit up will not really affect you. I think that a lot more often people are focused on respectability when it comes to things like that. Oh, those white people are fucking shit up and we're going to get blamed. I'm not bothered personally. You know, I don't care if white people think that I dressed up in a suit to go to the protest and was peaceful. I don't care if white people think I burned a whole building down. I don't care, because the reason I would be out there is not for white people. And it's not about proving white people wrong. So I definitely, I definitely hear that. And it's definitely, it's a tough thing to answer. It's a tough thing to consider, because you're asking, we're trying to sit here and consider, you know, how in danger are you in as a black person at a peaceful protest? How endangered are you if white people are present fucking shit up and you're adjacent to that? You know,
right? It sort of requires you it requires some real cognitive dissonance to imagine that black people are suddenly safe at a nonviolent protest. And I think also, you know, I mean, you mentioned history, right? Or like, you know, stories of the past, and you know, we all just, you know, just witnessed, you know, John Lewis passed, right? Like one of, like, people have been calling him iconic and heroic and all this kind of stuff. And I think that would probably drive him nuts. I think that, you know, legit, like, he had a tactic and a strategy and he was dedicated to it. It was a principled practice that he was dedicated to, right? But really, walk up to him and ask him, do you think that, you know, that sitting at X, Y, or Z counter, or walking over X, Y, or Z bridge, getting fired upon while you ain't doing shit, right? Like, you ain't do nothing, right? But while you're being passive and other people are actively committing violence against you, like, would he actually say that that was a nonviolent protest? That no violence had occurred that day, right? But like, what people often forget, when we're talking about, when we're having discourse around nonviolence or nonviolent protests or civil disobedience, et cetera, and so forth, is that it really does require that, if it's really going to be nonviolent, it requires all actors to not be violent. And when
the state
folks are showing up,
the state can never comply with that because it's a colonialist state. So that's already out of the window. You know what I mean?
And when the state, shows up in full riot gear and I'm wearing a janky ass COVID-19 fake mask and like a hoodie, you know, when the state shows up in full surveillance gear and I've got like my cell phone that I turned off, you know, cause security culture, like, A, forget a fair fight. We're talking about people who came ready to inflict maximum violence versus people who came ready to demonstrate to the maximum their displeasure with being repressed by the state, right? So then if you bring all of that, you know, I'm going to keep on trying to reel us right back into education because it's so real and it's so, like, all of this, like the policing, the surveillance, all of this begins in school. In this country, like I can't speak for other countries, and maybe if there are folks from other countries, I know I saw Ecuador in the house a little while ago, like there are folks from other countries, maybe you can speak to this too, but our practices around, like why I brought up John Lewis and his actual practice, like of like a very disciplined practice and principled practice, is because that's what that was, right? That wasn't John Lewis being like, you're bad. You better protest the way I said, goddammit. It was like, no. I'm going to practice this until I'm comfortable enough with this strategy to do it again and again and again. When we got our little kids in school, we're telling them that discipline is, if you don't do what I say, then something bad is going to happen to you. Right? We're teaching them that the only practice they need to get right is a practice of listening to me, the authority.
Of obedience, no matter what.
Right.
Like that's obedience right. to an outside authority, an authority outside of yourself.
That's right. And, you know, and again, so like it's asking for a complete detachment from yourself. And, you know, to a greater extent, a detachment from your community. Right. I think about like, so I haven't worked in public school in about 4.5-5 years. But I think about the kids that I worked with, specifically the little black kids that I worked with. It was almost exclusively. All right. I worked in a school in San Francisco where when I left San Francisco, the black population was like 3%. Right. The percentage of black kids that were expelled, sent out of class in my school alone was like 70%. And they made up 9% of the fucking school. So here's another word that everybody learned from reading Michelle Alexander's book, disproportionality, right? And trust me, this is all tied together. So we're talking about like how these kids get sent out of class because they were too loud, right? They weren't able to sit still. They might have said something out of pocket, right? All these things get you sent out of class, get you sent out of that place where also the person in charge, the teacher, is telling you, you're safe here. This is a safe place, over and over and over again. Every single day, these teachers are like, you're in a safe place. But I'm sorry, Tyrone, when you are doing X, Y, and Z, you're no longer safe. So now you got to go out of this classroom and into where? Right. Luckily, a lot of those kids had me and a couple of other folks, but they didn't, you know what I mean? And for what? Because we're asking them to follow, you know, like this usually white lady and her expectations around what behavior should be and looks like around all of these things. Right. But we're also asking these kids to sever themselves from maybe what they know about at home. Right. Maybe at home, like, You have to speak loudly for whatever the fuck reason. And it's nobody else's business, right? But the fact that, like, again, coming back to that wall of white, if we have to conform to these ways of being, we're immediately negatively disciplined, disproportionately so. And so when that wall of white turns on you at the demo or in the classroom or just, for example, at the DCFS meeting, damn what? Like, where do you go? Where do you turn? You've been disconnected from community already because you've been trying to toe this line. And so you're not even in community anymore. You're just out there for yourself doing what you do. It's a trip.
Yeah.
And it starts so early.
One thing that I immediately heard when you're talking about, you know, the offenses that kids commit in school, this idea of too loud or too disorderly or any of that. First of all, my first reaction is what? My second reaction is that immediately ingrains morality into all regular human behaviors that are adjusted based on situation. You know, like kids have a wealth of knowledge and practice at interfacing with many kinds of people. Because they have the least power almost everywhere they go. And so they're used to having to bend and change themselves for that environment. And one thing that can be very challenging for them is to create this circle of, you know, morality and shame of like, you're bad because you're too loud, you know? And like you mentioned, that doesn't acknowledge that they are loud for a specific reason based on a learned behavior, like based on a different situation where loudness was celebrated, loudness was necessary, loudness was useful to them, you know?
And where loudness is now considered violence, right?
Exactly.
Where justifiable anger and rage is considered violence.
And just coding, coding regular behaviors that, like, I don't want to say regular, coding reactions to scenarios, coding feelings, coding behaviors of children as bad, you know, rather than this isn't the best time for this. Or, you know, focusing on the framing of that is a big issue because it brings adults who view everything in the frame of morality. And attaching obedience and morality is a very big issue under the
system.
Because to be obedient is not to be good. If you're acting
That's
mean.
Right.
Like,
the state ain't asking you.
In schools, it creates an environment where one behavior, white approved, is the norm, and anything outside of that creates an othering, which is so unhealthy and dangerous to teach kids. Absolutely. You know, thank you, Alessia. Like, it is, the othering is a perfect word for this because it's talking about really, you know, on top of just now you're a bad person because you did something undesirable in the situation, like you're also severing the community between these kids, you know? Those are the bad kids. They sit over there. They're always in the office. Mm-hmm. We don't talk to them because we don't want to be bad too.
That's right.
You know,
That's
instead
right.
of viewing things as a spectrum of harm at, or it's usually not even harm, to be honest, but when it is, you know, like, are we saying, okay, one time this kid did blow up and hit this other kid, now they're a bad kid forever, and they're labeled a bad kid forever to contain, like, to follow them into infinity. And this is where we start talking about abolition, like, about prison abolition, about disposability politics, and about really considering, you know, what's a natural consequence versus a punishment, you know? And punishments have to do with obedience. And, you know, honestly,
All right, hold up.
Let's pause.
Hold up. You see it? We're going to pause. We're going to do a practice that I do in some of my other consultant work. Is everybody ready? I don't know if they're ready, but I hope you're ready. We're going to do a thing where for, I'm not even going to call it a full 60, for 30 seconds, we're going to be just totally still. I'm not saying that this is a meditation space. I'm not going to encourage you to do any sort of deep breathing. We're going to hold for 30 seconds.
I'm not going to encourage you to do any deep breathing.
Can you get with it? 30 seconds. Come on now.
I'm ready. Okay, I'm ready.
All right. I'm going to count backwards from 5, and we're going to go for 30 seconds. 4, 3, 2, 1. Three, two, one. All right, I like to do this practice in my own consultation because it gets live. And that was a whole lot of words. And I want to open it up to y'all for questions, thoughts, other words.
Are you wanting questions? Are you wanting reflections?
I want all of it. And we can wait. We're patient. We're black.
To be black is to be patient. Because you're definitely not getting what the fuck you want right now. You're not getting it right now. Maybe in a minute.
Because I know we also said that we were going to pause
Oh, you know, I'm thinking stuff that we didn't get to above in the chat.
Oh, let's go there.
So let me read a couple of things that people submitted. Someone said, violence exists in different levels, too. A gang of epistemic and pedagogical violence, especially within schooling. I think you did talk about that a bit. And then the next one is intersections / parallels of nonviolent communication and nonviolent protesting. I would like to talk about that.
So what I'd like to recommend, because we had said at the top of the hour that we were going to take a quick break and then come back. But can we take a break, come back at 5:10, and then start with intersections, parallels between nonviolent communication and nonviolent protest?
Yeah, and then I would like to start talking about policing.
Yeah, because we love the police so much.
Would you say? Yeah, I know. They get way too much free rent in my brain, to be honest. But yeah, I would like to talk a little bit about the history of policing. I would like to talk about crime for a little bit. And I want to talk about some selections from Anarchy Works, which details some.
All right.
So we have a
full hour
after the break.
We'll be back at, actually, you know what? We'll be back at 5:12. We need 10 minutes.
Hear about punishment.
Okay. And
yes, we will talk about that.
Oh yes. It's going to be good.
Thank y'all. Thanks,
everybody.
We'll see you shortly if you have time.
Thanks. Get some water.
Peace.
Peace.